My special program today deals with the time that we are doing this taping, namely October 31st, 2014. October 31st is the birthday of the state where I grew up, namely Nevada. Today is a special birthday for Nevada because it is the sesquicentennial, that is to say 150 years since Nevada became a state during the Civil War. In fact, its motto is Battleborn because it was entered the Union in 1864 during the Civil War when Abraham Lincoln needed some extra votes. And Nevada came in handy. I think they say that the entire Nevada Constitution was sent by telegraph to Washington, D.C., like on October 30th, 1864. And it was the longest telegram that had ever been sent, maybe one of the longest telegrams that ever was sent. When the Constitution for the state of Nevada was adopted. Anyway, I have a bunch of things to show for Nevada. And one of the things that I am stressing is the place where my brother still lives, because it is on Highway 50. I'm wearing my Highway 50 t-shirt. And there's a big 50 on there, U.S. Route 50, because U.S. Route 50 crosses central Nevada through Fallon, where my brother, who's 10 years younger than I am, still lives. And they call this the loneliest road in the U.S. Well, I don't know. I think there are probably some even lonelier roads elsewhere in the state of Nevada. But U.S. 50 does go across the state, entering at Wendover, I believe it is. Maybe I've got that one wrong. I may be thinking about the more usual route, which follows the Humboldt River. I do have a map here, which you aren't going to really be able to see, I think. I can see it, and I've got my fingers on it. It's a map of Nevada. Nevada, yes. I was a student on three different occasions, three different summer schools at the University of Nevada in Reno. And this was a nice gift from my son David and his wife Heather last Christmas. Nevada, the Wolf Pack, that must be the Nevada football team. Well, let me mention one other thing quickly about Nevada and tying it in with my own history, and that is that I have here a scarf that says Girl Scouts. Girl Scouts was a group that I was very active in as a girl in eighth grade in my freshman year in high school in central Nevada, not in Fallon, but in Hawthorne, where we lived during the Second World War and just after the Second World War. Well, why Girl Scouts? Not only because I was a member of Girl Scouts at that time, but also because today, October 31st, is the birthday of the founder of Girl Scouts, Juliet Gordon Lowe. And I have this beautiful scarf, which has many daisies on it because Juliet Gordon Lowe's nickname was Daisy. And I also have a very nice gift. Again, this was a gift from David and Heather. They went to Savannah, Georgia, which was the hometown of Juliet Gordon Lowe, and they brought back for me this very nice bag, which shows the place where Juliet Gordon Lowe lived as a girl and is now the national place that people visit who want to connect with Girl Scout history. In fact, in 2012, my granddaughter, Lana, went to Savannah with a group of Girl Scouts from Black Diamond Council, which, because they were celebrating the birth of Girl Scouts in Savannah in the year 1912, when Juliet Gordon Low organized the first Girl Scout troop. So there are a couple of other things about the 31st of October, but let's go on to some other information about Nevada. I have a dear friend, Judy Deso, who just returned, as it turns out, from Reno, Nevada, not too far from Fallon, about 75 miles from Fallon. Reno was a place that I knew well as a child, and later, as a teenager, I took piano lessons there, and even at one point some voice lessons in Reno. So here's the Reno Gazette Journal, and they have a picture of Abraham Lincoln, because after all, he played a very big role in the fact that Nevada became a state, despite the fact that it didn't have enough people. They say that there were supposed to be 100,000 before a territory, which Nevada had been for some years, became a state. But they sort of skipped over that when they put Nevada into the Union. And here is a picture also from the Reno Journal that Judy brought back for me to enjoy about Nevada Day, which is being celebrated all over the state today, the 150th anniversary of the it becoming a state. Here's the place, a picture of the place that, let's see whether this one will show up okay here on my other camera. Yes, there is Virginia City. Virginia City was what put Nevada on the map and led to statehood. Virginia City was where they discovered the silver ore for which Nevada is famous. Virginia City was, it was about 1857. It was 1858. It was after the growth of California, where gold had been discovered in 1848, and of course the 49ers were involved with that. But in Virginia City, they took out millions of dollars worth of silver ore over the years, actually from about at least 20 years from the 1850s and to the 1870s, that Virginia City was really in its prime. But it is still a wonderful place to visit. And I can remember visiting there when I was a little girl of 5 years old. My daddy, Ed, took me to Virginia City on my birthday, if I remember correctly. That would have been in June of 1937 that I first went to Virginia City. And I've been back, of course, a number of times to Nevada to visit my brother and his family. And here's a picture of my son. Let's see if we can put that so it can be seen. There he is, just outside Virginia City, with a pinyon pine behind him and one of the Nevada mountains. Nevada is famous for its mountains. They say it's the most mountainous state in the U.S. And why do they say that? It's because there are so many mountains that run particularly almost in parallels across the state, right across the state, they have what they call block fault geology, where mountains were rising on one side and valleys were going down on the other by earthquake activity for, you know, millions of years across Nevada. And there are still all these mountains that run, especially north and south, but a few of them even run east and west. And I visited there in the year 2000. I took even lonelier road, US 6, from Ely in eastern Nevada to Tonopah, where I lived as a girl, also, because we kept moving. We kept moving around, and that's some of the history that I'm going to be showing you now about Nevada. So I want to begin talking about where I lived in Nevada by showing you a picture of my mother. This is the account of her life that I wrote up in the 1990s. This picture was taken when my mother was active in Nevada politics. She was elected to the Nevada legislature in 1936 and was in the assembly, the only woman in the House, or the assembly as they call it in Nevada, during that year in 1937. And this picture was taken in 1936, I believe, when she was in New York briefly, and then in Philadelphia at the Democratic National Convention. So she, as I say, this was a picture of her then. And I will also show you a picture which shows her with her two children, namely me and my brother, Bill, at a time when we were little guys, quite little guys. It's here in my family history of my mother. Let's see, here I think we've got it. There's a picture of me. Here I am over on this side. I was two at the time this was made. It was in 1934. Let's see, can you show the picture? There we go, yeah. There I am, my finger pointing toward my mother with her hat and me sitting on a piano stool. She wrote a letter about this occasion. Like I say, I was two years old at the time, and she was visiting in Los Angeles. And, you know, two-year-olds, terrible twos and all that. I had to have my hair cut. I had to put on this new dress. She said I just yelled and screamed and so forth. But the photographer had a little puppet, a little hand puppet of a kitten. And he flashed this hand puppet of the kitten, and I had a big smile all of a sudden. All the tears sort of ran away, and there I am with a big smile in spite of everything. The other picture shows my mother about 10 years later with my brother when he was a baby. His name is Bill William Du Bois Washburn. And here he is at age one with my mother. This would have been in 1943. She's wearing a dress that I later wore myself, a black dress with a beautiful pink sort of sash kind of thing going over the shoulders. And there she is with my brother Bill in 1943. Well, anyway, how did my mother get out to Nevada? How did I get to Nevada? That is the question. My father, Daddy Ed, and my mother had been living in New York City, and I was born in New York City, June 20th, 1932. And it was at the very depths of the Depression, actually. My Mother used to see men, you know, walking down the street looking in garbage cans to see if they could find something to eat. It was the absolutely worst time of the Depression in 1932, and Franklin D. Roosevelt was nominated by the Democratic Party. He was governor of New York State at the time, to be the candidate for president against the sitting president, who was a Republican, Herbert Hoover, and for whom the big dam down near Las Vegas, Hoover Dam, is named because it was planned during the presidency of President Hoover. Actually, Hoover was so unpopular because of the Depression that it was called, after the canyon which the dam was put up, it was called Boulder Dam, and that's what I knew it as a girl growing up in Nevada, was Boulder Dam, now today Hoover Dam. Well, my father had a friend whose father had was involved with some property in southern Nevada, not too far from Las Vegas, actually, between Las Vegas and Death Valley, in a little place. Well, it wasn't a little place. It was a big, pretty big valley, actually, that had wonderful artesian springs in it. And the place was called Pa Rump. Pa Rump. Now, Pa is the Paiute word for water. And the word Pa or Pai, P-A-I, P-A-H, occurs in a number of place names throughout Nevada and Arizona, Utah, because of the Paiute connection. So my father got a job managing a big ranch at Pa Rump, which was 14,000 acres. And he went out in early 1933. And in March of 1933, my mother and I joined him out there. And let's see if I can find this picture of me in Pa Rump. Here's the little history of Pa Rump that was a sort of an update that was made by a man who was born and grew up not very far from here, actually, in Hillsboro, West Virginia, down in southern, sort of eastern, southeastern Virginia. His father was a minister there when he was born in about 1914, I guess, actually, he was born there. And he had moved out to Nevada sometime and to Pa Rump, and he wrote a history of Pa Rump, which when I read it, here's this book called His Story of Pa Rump in Nye County, Nevada. I found this in the little library in Pa Rump when I visited it in 1986. It was very, very different from the days when my parents had been there and my mother had taught in the mid-1930s in the school at Pa Rump, which had like 14 students in it, half of them Indians, I'm still in touch with the Jim family. But he had written this book in the early 1980s, and there was no mention of my parents who were there from 1933 to early 1937, almost 4 years. And so I kind of wondered about that. But some other people that I knew of were mentioned in the book, including the Jim family. Alice Jim was my nursemaid, so to speak, whatever. She took care of me as a little girl, as first as a baby, and then later on as a growing up, you know, toddler and all that sort of thing. Let's see if I can find a picture that shows me. Yeah, here I am. shortly after we arrived in Pahrump. This must have been the spring of 1933. And there I am sitting in a basin of water on a doorstep in Pahrump. You can't see me too well, but there I am, sitting right there and got a big smile on my face. I was enjoying the water, I guess, as a little one. And then later on, I found a picture of me. I'm not sure that I can find it in this place because it's kind of all mixed up with the different stories. But here I am in 1935 on a horse with my new cousin. Well, he wasn't my cousin in those days because in 1935, his mother had not yet married my uncle, Worth Hatch. But there we are sitting on a big horse and enjoying it a lot. And down below, we're sitting on a hammock. Here's Jimbo in his sailor suit. He was about 2 years older than me. And here I am sitting next to him in the hammock in Pahrump when we were just little guys in 1935. Well, I mentioned about Pahrump having this name that means water, water something. They're not exactly sure exactly what the water something is, but the Indians who lived in Pahrump, and this is the beautiful basket that I have that was made in the 1930s that I think that was made especially for me because it's quite a small basket, and of course I was quite a little girl at the time. Here's the basket, which we can see up close, I think, there. Let's see, get it over so it's a little better. And there we go. This is a willow basket made by Mary, the wife of Whispering Ben and a relative of Chief Tecopa and of the Jim family. I'm still in touch with the granddaughter of Mary, the wife of Whispering Ben, who made this basket in the 1930s. And it has, around the top, it has raindrops and lightning flashes around the top. And then it has, see those diamonds? Those diamonds are mountains. Those diamonds are mountains. And on the bottom, there are coyote tracks. Coyote tracks. So it's actually a desert landscape. It shows rain, welcome rain, and lightning for a storm, the mountains of Nevada, and coyote tracks. And so it's a landscape on this basket itself. Well, we were in Pahrump until 1937, and then we moved. I mentioned visiting Virginia City in the summer of 1937 when I had my fifth birthday. But after my mother was elected to the legislature, something interesting happened suddenly. She divorced my father, Daddy Ed, and married George Washburn, who was the father of my brother, Bill, who was born in 1942. But it was a time for me that was sort of unsettling, as you might imagine. My mother was busy in Carson City, which is the state capital of Nevada, as an assemblywoman, the only woman in the Nevada Assembly that year. And I went traveling with my father. We went to Los Angeles, where he had relatives, and San Francisco, where his father lived. And then we went to Lake Tahoe and he had a job at Lake Tahoe that summer, 1937. Lake Tahoe is right on the corner where Nevada goes from up and down to. All of a sudden, quite a steep angle down to near where Las Vegas is and so on. And I was there in Lake Tahoe in summer of 1937 with my father, Daddy Ed. But that winter, he died in Phoenix, Arizona. He had only one kidney because as a child he'd been exposed to tubercular cow milk in England, where his family was living at the time. And he had had to have a kidney taken out when he was in his 20s. And then when the other kidney failed in 1937, he was only 34 years old. But that was the end of him because, of course, in those days they didn't have the things that they can do nowadays, where they can clear out the poisons that accumulate and are supposed to be washed out by the kidneys. But in those days, it was before they had dialysis, and so he died when I was 5. By that time, I was staying with my mother. The Nevada legislature, like the West Virginia legislature, is not in session for very long. I think they were in session for like a couple of months, and then they closed up shop and would only be called back if the governor thought that it was necessary to do so. So by then, my mother was going around Nevada with my new stepfather, George Washburn, who was working on the roads. He was a highway engineer, a motor grader operator, and a person who could do anything. You know, he was a jack of all trades, as a lot of men were in the old days, and still some are, but fewer, I'm afraid, than back then, because he could do, he made wonderful shelves and a big bin for flour in the little house that we lived in Tonopah. And he could do anything with cars, fix cars up. He could do things with electricity. And he also, at one time in the early 30s, had helped build a little house for his mother in out of railroad ties. He and several of his brothers, he was one of a large family of boys, all grown up by that time, of course, since he was born in 1899, George Washburn, my beloved stepfather. Well, let's take a look here, too, at, I showed you the basket and about the Paiute, talked about the Paiute Indians. And the Paiute Indians are divided into at least two groups in Nevada. The southern Paiutes, who live near Pahrump and in southern Nevada, and the northern Paiutes, who lived near Fallon, where Highway 50 is in Fallon. So I knew Paiutes in both places. When I was a girl in Fallon, I can remember seeing the old men and women, the old Indian men and women coming into town to Fallon. They would usually come on Saturdays in their wagons from Stillwater, and they would just sort of sit there and enjoy themselves, maybe do a little shopping. But this book is a really wonderful, wonderful book that was photographed by and written up by a woman in Fallon named Margaret Wheat. Margaret Wheat is best known for this book called The Survival Arts of the primitive Paiutes. And she took pictures back in the late 1940s when there were still some of these old men and women, Indian men and women, living near Fallon. And they were people who actually were mostly interested in the watery places and swampy places that are not too far from Fallon, because, you know, what happens to Nevada rivers is they finally peter out because there's not enough water to keep them going. The rivers flow out of the Sierra Nevada mountains and Lake Tahoe. From Lake Tahoe, where I spent 8 wonderful summers in the 1930s and 40s, the Truckee River flows north to the little town of Truckee in eastern California, and then flows into Nevada through Reno and through the Truckee Canyon, where my stepfather's family lived in they moved there in 1904, about when they were building a dam on the Truckee River to take some water, divert some of the Truckee River water to send to Fallon, because it was an interesting thing. There was a fellow back in that day by the name of Francis Newlands, who was the senator from Nevada. He was first senator sent by the legislature, chosen by the legislature in the 1890s. And then later he was elected by the voters after the passage of the amendment, which provided for the direct election of senators. Anyway, Francis Newlands was a big man for irrigation, and he had this plan. In fact, he had such a good plan in mind that he bought up some of the land around Fallon and in the Truckee area and on the Carson River in order to be in at the beginning, which he was. He was there at the beginning. They put a dam on the Truckee at the little town of Derby, where my Daddy George's mother lived, and who I remember. Her name was Mary Washburn. She was quite an old lady when I first met her, and in fact, she passed away within a year or two of my entering the family. I remember she used to heat the old irons on her stove, which was going continually, a wood stove, you know, with coal and wood. Or she also had one of those old-fashioned great big irons that had gas, that ran on gas. It had a little tank of gas on it, which was used to heat the flat iron bottom. And I remember watching her iron clothes with that, as well as with the old flat irons that were heated on the stove. Because this was in the 1930s, you know, and there wasn't any electricity at that time in 1936, 37. There wasn't electricity, I don't believe, yet. Or maybe she just didn't have an electric iron at the time. Anyway, she was one of the other women that I remember, Mary Washburn, who had been born in Germany, came to the United States, Mary Campman, in the 1870s, and died in 1938. But she was one of the many people who came as an immigrant into the United States. And she married a man originally from Illinois called Squire Thomas Washburn, who was notorious in the family for being a kind of a mean guy. He was such a mean guy that all the kids as soon as they were old enough, you know, like about 12 or 13 or 14, left home and struck out on their own. But their mother still lived there in Derby near the Truckee River, and the Derby Dam was built there in the early days of the 20th century, about 1904. In fact, here's a picture, let's see if we can get it on here, of the Derby Dam when it was brand new, up the Truckee River, just a little ways from the Nevada Ranch. And here's the dam itself. This part is the dam. Frances Newland, Senator Newland's wife, was the person who came along and initiated the dam by smashing a bottle of champagne in this part where the dam river was, and the spillways could let water go further down the Truckee River, because the Truckee River runs between two lakes, between Lake Tahoe and Pyramid Lake in the western part of Nevada, north east of Reno. Pyramid Lake is where the Truckee River winds up. And most of those river areas were granted to the Indian tribes that lived near them, including the Pyramid Indian Reservation, so-called pyramid because it has a strange rock formation that looks like a pyramid on one side of the pretty big lake that is Pyramid Lake. Those lakes are the remnants of the huge lake that crossed what was prehistoric, at least as far as the whites were concerned, prehistoric Nevada, after the glaciers melted, you know, started melting about 10,000 BC. And so there was this huge lake across what is today the state of Nevada, with all these mountains sticking up out of it as islands all across Nevada, these mountains running north and south. They say there are over 300 mountains ranges in Nevada. If you add them all up, of course, they sort of kind of run together, except that there are these valleys between them, as I mentioned, because of the geology, the block fault geology of the state. And all of these mountain ranges across central Nevada are called Toyabe National Forest. They don't actually link to each other because there are these river valleys between them. Or I shouldn't say river valleys, because most of them don't have any river in them. There's only one called Reese River, which runs up and empties eventually into the Humboldt. But as I was saying, these rivers run into the desert, the Nevada desert, from the Sierra Nevadas. The two of them in particular that are best known are there are three. There is the Truckee, the farthest north, which goes through Reno. There is the Carson, which goes near Carson City. And farther south, there is the Walker River, which runs into Walker Lake, near where we lived during the World War II, and where I was a Girl Scout, near Walker Lake and Hawthorne and Babbitt, Nevada, in the 1940s, the mid-1940s. Well, the rivers that disappear into the desert, essentially, the river that disappears into the desert running out of the Sierras is the Carson River. And it ran into where Fallon is. And there was a lake called Carson Lake, but the river branched into two parts near Fallon, before Fallon was even there, of course. One branch went into Carson Lake to the south, and the other branch went sort of to the north out near Stillwater and the Carson Sink, where the river just, that part of the river just disappeared into the desert. And there was a big marshy place, which is still there today and is part of the flyway, which nourishes the birds that fly north in the summertime, and or in the springtime mostly, and fly south in the fall. And then there's the river that runs across the northern part, north-central part of Nevada, called the Humboldt River, which arises in the far eastern part, runs through the town of Elko, where later I used to go when I was teaching on the Indian reservation north of Elko, and goes on to Battle Mountain and Winnemucca, named for a famous Indian chief who had a daughter who was a guide and a scout. Her name, Sarah Winnemucca, was a important member of the, I think maybe she was a Shoshone, that I would think that she would have been Shoshone, Western Shoshone from where she lived, as opposed to the Paiutes in the western part of Nevada, the Western Shoshone band, which is related to the Paiutes, are found in the eastern and northern part of Nevada. And the reservation where I taught when I finished college in 1952-53 is the Western Shoshone Reservation, or the Duckwater Indian Reservation, part of it being in the state of Idaho. It's so far north, it's right on the border between Nevada and Idaho. But there was another one of my Indian connections was that year that I taught fifth grade at Swain School in northern Nevada and southern Idaho. The school itself was in Nevada and was under the overlordship, so to speak, of the Nevada education system, because the school was in the town of Owyhee, which sounds kind of like Hawaii, doesn't it? But it's spelled totally differently. O-W-Y-H-E-E, Owyhee. But some people say that probably there was an idea that there was a place out there in the west, in the far west, far, far out in the Pacific even, called Hawaii, H-A-W-A-I-I, Hawaii. Well, let's see, where were we? Well, we were talking about the rivers and how the Humboldt also goes from eastern Nevada and flows to the west through Elko, Battle Mountain, Winnemucca, and Lovelock, and then it disappears into the Humboldt Sink, just south of Lovelock. And between the Humboldt River and the Carson River, there's 40 miles of no water. Now, that doesn't mean much today, when my son David and I visited Nevada and went along US 80 and to as far as Lovelock, and then turned south to Fallon, we crossed the infamous 40-mile desert that was the most terrible part of the route that went across Nevada and it wound up in Sacramento, essentially, because of the 40 miles with no water at all. And after leaving the Humboldt and the Humboldt Sink, there was this spot 40 miles long where there was no water. And one time I wrote a story about this. Let's see, here it is, I guess it is. I'll pull it out here, this book. This shows the Churchill County, that's where Fallon is, Fallon's the county seat. This is the Churchill County Focus, In Focus it's called. It's the Historical Society publication. And when I took a history in 2004, I read up on the 40-mile desert because it had been so close to where I lived in Fallon at one time. Like I say, when my son and I drove across the 40-mile desert at night, as it happened, we didn't see anything. It took us about an hour to get from Lovelock to Fallon. But it would take people in a wagon 10 or 11 days to cross the 40-mile desert, and with no water. You know, everyone said get as much water as you can get when you leave the Humboldt River and the Humboldt Sink. Get as much water as you can, and the next place you're going to get water is on the Carson River, and the Carson River flowing out of the Sierras to the east and then disappearing into Carson Lake and Carson Sink. So I wrote this account of the 40-mile desert and what a terrible trek that was to the people who had to cross it. During the, for the most part, those stories were from the days of the 49ers, because and that was before Nevada became a state, obviously. 1848, the discovery of gold in California, and then 49, when so many people thinking they were going to find gold in California took off, that they're called the 49ers. Two of the stories that I wrote about, not stories, historic accounts by women who kept diaries of their trek across the 40-mile desert in 1849, and how tough that was. But they finally made it to the Carson River. In both cases, these people went to the Carson River. They could have gone a little farther north and headed for the Truckee River, but the Carson River was a little better, I guess, especially after the Donner Party had their problems in the 1846, along the near the Truckee River. But anyway, this account, In Focus, the Churchill County Historical Magazine, tells about the 40-mile desert. And so that was one reason why people who, like Francis Newlands, were so interested in irrigation. They wanted to set up a big dam on the Carson River called Lahontan near Fallon, which they did, which is still there. I think that this picture is so small you'll scarcely be able to see it, but I'm going to put it by up by Nessie in case Tyler can show. There's the Lahontan Dam with its spillways up near the top, and then down below is what's left of the river and the canals, the starting of the canals that made Fallon such a wonderful irrigated section, and it still is. That's where my brother still is, an irrigated rancher near Fallon, Nevada. Well, but let me just point out one part here, which you can't really see too well, but there is a shooting of water that's coming into this river or canal that is below Lahontan Dam, and that shooting of water is coming from the Truckee River. From the Derby Dam, they had a big canal, and as you can imagine, a lot of water just disappeared into the into the atmosphere on this 40-mile canal that they dug between Derby Dam on the Truckee River and near Lahontan Dam on the Carson River. But that's why it's called the Truckee-Carson Irrigation District, because it had water both from the Truckee River and from the big dam on the Carson River, Lahontan Dam. Well, let's see. What else do we need to talk about here? Oh, yeah, I should show this other. Well, this is the book about called Conflict on the Carson. Conflict on the Carson, which shows what a battle they had. They had a battle that lasted for about 50 years over the water rights on the Carson River. And this woman who wrote this book, Conflict on the Carson, was published in the 1970s. She was a very old lady by then. She was born in 1896, and her father had been a rancher on the upper reaches of the Carson River, just where it flowed out of the Sierra Nevada south of Carson City. And so there was this big row about water and who gets the water. You know, do the people upstream on the Carson River get the water, or most of the water, or is the river going to flow down and out into the desert and go to the Carson Sink and Carson Lake and to Lahontan Dam eventually? And that was a long, long lawsuit which lasted about 50 years, they say. Anyway, Grace Dangberg wrote this book called Conflict on the Carson. And there's a picture of Grace Dangberg on the back there as quite an old lady. She was a famous Nevada historian of her day. And like I say, her father was intimately involved in it, and she had been raised in Carson Valley upstream. Anyway, people in Fallon got plenty of water eventually, and the dam on the Lahontan Dam on the Carson River was completed about 1914. But it was started because it was the first of the big dams that was built, almost the first of the big dams that was built with federal money, because that's what Francis G. Newlands did, was get federal money from Theodore Roosevelt's administration in 1902 with the passage of reclamation. What they called reclamation there meant reclaiming the desert by bringing water to the irrigated ranches and farms in across the West, many places across the West, but beginning then. So these are some of the stories that I have to tell. I also want to mention, here is a picture of me. I'm going to show this again over here. There I am, I'm saying, "Hello, Dolly." Dolly was my nickname as a girl. All the people who ever call me Dolly are my cousins and people like that. It says, "Hello, Dolly," because that's the t-shirt that I got when they put on "Hello, Dolly" at the high school when I was on the school board. And I'm holding this basket. And I'm holding another basket as well, because a lady who went to Pahrump when I was a little girl of 4 years old sent me her Indian basket when I got in touch with her in 1986. And I kept that basket until after Dorothy Waring's death about the year 2000, when I thought it was only fair to send the basket back to her daughter because the daughter had grown up with that basket, you know, for 30 years or 40 years before Dorothy Waring from Connecticut sent it to me. But there's the Connecticut connection. And one of the things I want to mention about the Connecticut connection is this book called Letters from Harry, 1872 to 1874. This is one of those fantastic, marvelous connections between that you find in history. These letters were to a man called Henry Osborne Taylor, who became a famous historian at Harvard University. But when he was a young teenage boy of 15, he went out to Nevada, to Austin, which is on the loneliest road in the West, 110 miles to the east of Fallon, the first real settlement town. To the east of Fallon is 110 miles away in the city of Austin, the town of Austin, Nevada. Well, his father, Henry Osborne Taylor's father, owned more than one mine. He had a whole series of mines, and he had a company called the Manhattan Company, because although he was his family was originally from Connecticut, Middletown, Connecticut, he had set up this mine called the Manhattan Mine when he was living in New York City, and his young son, who was about 15 going on 16, went out to work in that mine in 1872, and he was there from 1872 to 1874. And all these letters were found many years later by the great niece of this Professor Taylor. And they are absolute treasure of getting a feel for what life was really like, at least one side of it, because those were all the letters that were sent to Harry, which he kept, his letters that he had sent back east during that two-year period just disappeared, you know, and they're not a part of history. But this was a fantastic story about the town of Austin on the loneliest road of the West, and how in the 1860s, 70s, and into the 80s, this Manhattan mine complex in Austin was a part of the history of Nevada. Yeah, you're right. Here it's, I'm just showing one page from this. It says Harry's left in charge. He was only 16 at the time, but he was representing his father. So here is the town of Austin on the loneliest road in the West, which was a part of the territory that became the Pony Express in 1860 for just a while, right across central Nevada, from near Fallon all the way to Utah, and was only in business for 1 year, because then they put in a telegraph, and so who needed a Pony Express anymore when you had a telegraph to bring these things in? So there we go. There's Fallon in the day that I was there in 1940. Downtown Fallon, where my brother still lives, and I celebrate the loneliest road in the West. And it says I survived, actually, Route 50, but they're talking about 50 around Nevada. And happy sesquicentennial to the state of Nevada on October 31st, 2014. This is Lois Whaley for Women Today and Yesterday. Thank you.